How do you call yourself a feminist? What is it about feminism that you are in support of?
I think it's become a very empty signifier in the West, feminism. The liberals want it just to be the doctrine of total gratification of individual desire. What actually happened was that men and women together needed to respond to the way life was changed by the Industrial Revolution. And I think, you know, why shouldn't we take it back? You know, it does mean something. Women still exist. You know, we're still distinct from men in some politically important ways. Why shouldn't we have it back? It could just as easily be ours as theirs.
Welcome back to the Lila Rose podcast. Today we're going to have a lively and fun discussion with Mary Harrington, who's a British author and the writer of the Substack Reactionary Feminist. What is a reactionary feminist? Mary will break it down. We're going to talk about the rights of women in the Middle Ages versus women in the industrial and post-industrial revolutionary time period. We're going to talk about this idea of transhumanist healthcare. Mary has some great insight into that, as well as this idea of the industrialization of women's bodies, what that means today. And then Mary has some, I think, rather sage advice for how we can work our way out of some of the chaos of today. And some of her recommendations include getting married and letting men have some of their own spaces back. So a lot of interesting discussion for someone that still calls herself a feminist, and I think there's a lot of food for thought here. As always, don't forget to subscribe to the podcast wherever you listen to your shows, and watch us on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel, and you can subscribe there and ring the notification bell so that you never miss an episode. A big thank you to our sponsor, NimiSkincare.com, NIMISkincare.com. I've been using the Nimi Skincare line products for the last several months, and I love their products. This is a company that holds timeless values, so they are in line with our pro-life and pro-family values. Their products are clean, simple, and easy to use. There's a ton of research that has gone into the development of their products. Over the last decade, I've tried a ton of brands, and unfortunately, a lot of the skincare brands out there and beauty brands out there are pro-abortion, and I have never been satisfied with the products that I've used. Not so with Nimi. I think you're going to love Nimi. I use their hydration cream, their deep hydration cream. I use their brightening sunscreen. I put that on every morning. It's very moisturizing. Again, the products are clean, easy to use. The formulas are great, and I think you're going to love it. So go today to NimiSkincare.com, NIMISkincare.com. Check them out. You can use the code Lila at checkout for 15% off your order. That's 15% off the order with the code Lila at checkout. Prayer can change your life, prayer can make you live longer, and prayer, I think, is essential to deepening our relationship with God, our creator. And that's why I love the number one prayer app, which is Hallow. If you haven't checked out Hallow already, you should absolutely download them today at the link in the bio. You get 3 months free at the link in the bio. But what's so beautiful about Hallow is it's an amazing app. They have many, many features for whatever you're looking for, whether they're more traditional prayers, holy scripture, reading spiritual meditations, learning about the saints, learning about Bible stories. There's sleep stories. There's a ton of kids content on there. My four-year-old loves listening to the kids content on Hallow. He keeps asking for it. We have to keep replaying the same content because he just loves it. I think you're going to find what you're looking for, and it's going to help you, whether it's on your commute or you're doing dishes or whatever you're doing, deepen your relationship with God. Even just 10 minutes a day can really make a huge difference. So check them out today. Download the Hallow app in the link in the bio. Get 3 months free and enjoy deepening your prayer journey and drawing closer to God. Mary Harrington, thanks so much for joining the show.
Thank you for having me.
I've heard amazing things about you. We had Erica Bakiaki on several months ago, who I have the greatest respect for. And she's been telling me for a long time, you need to have Mary Harrington on the show. So here we are.
Okay. Well, it's great to be here.
So tell me a little bit about, you have a Substack called Reactionary Feminist. And you're not your typical feminist, though. You're new age, or I would say a modern wave feminist. I'd love to just start, you've got fascinating writing. A lot of your articles, I've loved reading them. So I'd just like to first start to understand your background, your journey to what you are now at, as, yes, the title Reactionary Feminist.
Okay, so I only became a writer kind of by mistake. Well, no, that's not true. I wasn't by mistake, but it was late. I always wanted to be a writer, but I was kind of nuts in my 20s. I was very leftist. I lived in a very experimental way. We'll just leave it there. And by the end of my 20s, my life kind of fell apart. And to cut a long story, a very long story, pretty short. By the time I came out of that, I'd questioned a lot of the things that I believed previously. I also got married. I no longer lived in London. And I think the thing which really changed my outlook on life was that I became a mum. By then, I'd pretty much also given up on being employable in any way at all. You know, I'd always wanted to be a writer, but I'd tried a billion different jobs, and I'd been terrible at all of them. And I was pretty cool at that point with the idea that I was going to be a stay-at-home mum. And furthermore, there was nothing just a mum about being a mum. You know, that this was great, and I was really enjoying it, and there was lots there to think about. And these were all things which I think I'd internalized a lot of beliefs about, you know, that being a stay-at-home mum means to be just a mum, that there's something diminished or low status or inferior or letting the side down about doing that. And when it came to it, when I realized I had the choice, I was fortunate to have the choice because of how things were for us financially, about whether or not I wanted to go back to work. And I realized I've done all of these jobs and I sucked at all of them. And there is literally nothing that anyone could offer to pay me to do that I could realistically do, that I want to do more than being with my baby. And I realized that the fact that I was in that position made me that didn't make me oppressed. That made me lucky relative to a lot of the women who'd been my peers in antenatal groups. You know, many of whom maybe they thought their jobs were okay. Maybe they didn't love them so much, but there was no not going back to work after maternity leave. It just simply wasn't a choice. So that made me rethink a lot of things. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I have to ask, Mary, sorry to interrupt you, but you went from, you know, you said, you know, fairly leftist and living this life as a young person in university or whatever. And then all of a sudden you're a stay at home, you get married and you're a stay at home mom. What was the events or the thought process that made you go from this leftist, as you called yourself, to now saying, I want to be a stay at home mom?
This isn't quite such a kind of record scratch thing as it might sound when I tell the story short, because we're talking about a period of like 10 years and a lot can happen in 10 years. So in my late 20s, I was leading a pretty bohemian life. My life kind of fell apart around the time I met my husband, around the time of the global financial crash. And it just that led me to re-examine a lot of the things I believed before. In the course of re-examining all of those things, I retrained as a psychotherapist, which again was, you know, there's a whole lot of soul searching involved in that kind of training. You do a lot of personal work. You think a lot about, I mean, you know, you might, some people might say it involves too much navel gazing. I don't know, but it was very beneficial for me. It led me to rethink very deeply a lot of the ways I approach the world, and as part of that, and somehow I came out the other end of that process having sort of resolved a lot of the things I'd previously been conflicted about, and having got married and decided that I did want to be a mum. And by the time I finally got there, I was 38. So, you know, an older mum. I think we were, it was a few years from my getting married to having a baby. And by the time I got there, I was 38. I think I was 40 before I started writing. And over the course of that time, becoming a mum really concretized a lot of things for me about where I'd had some blind spots about what being a feminist meant, or what it meant to think about being a woman, really. You know, I realized that, you know, from the perspective of a young woman who's maybe ambitious, who has big dreams about life, you know, who maybe doesn't feel safe walking down the street at night, a whole host of different, you know, who feels uncomfortable in her body, as I really did in my teens and early 20s, is very ambivalent about sex roles and gender roles. And all of this stuff, which is very common now, I guess I was kind of an early adopter of most of that stuff. When I became a mum, I realized that a lot of that stuff is very ungrounded if it's not understood in the context of why women are different to men. You know, it sounds so obvious when you say it like that. But the differences between men and women are very embodied and very basic. And in some ways they don't matter a whole lot, and in other ways they matter immeasurably and completely change how you experience life. I mean, having a child was, you know, obviously a very different experience for me and for my husband, but it also completely changed the way I thought, you know, and felt, you know, I'm a good driver. I've driven for many years, and literally the only time I've ever crashed a car in nearly, God, I don't know, like more, several decades of driving, literally the only time I've ever damaged a car was when I had a hungry baby screaming in the back and I just could not think. And this
been
sounds
there.
Right.
Not
right.
The crashing part, but I thankfully didn't do the crash, and hopefully it won't do it in the future. But I totally
but there's
relate.
A, there's a kind of thought terminating feeling of desperation that comes in where really it's safer just to pull the car over and breathe into a paper bag for a minute, because it's that visceral, the reaction you have. And I remember completely freaking out because my dentist appointment was 10 minutes late, and I thought my baby might wake up before I got home, totally freaking out. And you know, when I got, she was fine, she was with my mum, she was chill, but I was completely freaked out, in absolute state. And all of this stuff was completely new to me, and it led me to re-examine some of the basic beliefs which I'd always taken for granted as kind of foundational to feminism, that men and women are basically the same, apart from some kind of slightly different topography and slightly different genitals, that we're basically the same kind of creature. That we should be aiming for the same things, that our political priorities can and should be broadly the same. And that being a woman is basically like being a man but on hard mode. Yeah, that was, I suppose, the kind of unexamined premise. And then that got overlaid with a whole load of critical theory and Judith Butler at university, which led me to imagine that maybe I could LARP my way out of it. Which, as it turned out, I mean, I tried. I sincerely tried. In a kind of playful way, I tried LARPing my way out of gender roles and expectations. I don't think I was ever that committed to the bit, but not like the kids are now. But I tried just to see what would happen, and it turned out that doesn't really work either. And there really is something irreducible underneath it. Anyway, here I was, age 38, 39. You know, having really run the gamut of modern third wave feminism, I guess, and come to a point where not only was I a stay-at-home mum, which was the one thing I was vowed I was never going to do, but actually I was having quite a nice time doing it. And somewhere along the way as well, I guess, I think the other important bit of the story is that I lost my faith in progress. I stopped believing that progress is a thing. I came to realize that we tell this story to ourselves, it's just in the air, about how it's always better to go forward than to go backwards, that somehow the world is progressing towards, away from something bad and towards something good, that history, that things which happened in the past and people in the past were always less ignorant than we are. Yeah, I mean, you know the framework I'm talking about. It's just everywhere. It's the sort of ambient belief system. I came to realise I didn't believe in it anymore. And then, you know, I put those bits together. You know, you have to imagine me pushing my buggy around small town England with a little baby in it. you do that a lot. And so there I am with my buggy, and you know, and all of this stuff kind of goes around my head, because it's not like your brain stops working just because you're a mum. It's not like you stop being a thinking human being just because you're a stay-at-home mum. So here I am thinking about progress, and I'm thinking about feminism, and I'm thinking about what life is like, especially after all of my antenatal group peers started going back to work. I started thinking about the question of work and the question of privilege, and you know, the luxury of being able to be a stay-at-home mum, and it made me realize a lot of the things that I believed just seemed to be kind of backwards. Like, a lot of the things I'd just taken, assumed were true. I was like, hang on, I've got all of this backwards. You know, this isn't oppressive. Maybe for some people it's oppressive, but I don't feel like I'm oppressed. You know, who is actually being oppressed here, and, you know, according to who? And furthermore, you know, if I still think of myself as a feminist, but I don't believe in progress, is that even possible? Because, I mean, because I'd have these conversations with people, and I'd be like, well, I'm not sure progress is a thing. And they're like, aha, but do you want to go back to when women couldn't vote? That's progress, isn't it? And I'm like, yeah, I suppose. So, you know, if the idea of, you know, the women's movement is so bound up in the idea of progress that the one gets used to prove the other, and vice versa, is it still possible to be a feminist if you don't believe in progress? So anyway, very short. The answer to that question, I guess, ended up being a whole book, which is called Feminism Against Progress. So you can see where I came down. Yeah, I think you can be a feminist if you don't believe in progress. And furthermore, if you want to be a feminist, you shouldn't believe in progress. Was the conclusion I came to in the end.
So there's so much to unpack there. I have so many questions for you about your journey and about what it means to be a feminist against progress, as you say. You know, you have your book, Feminism Against Progress. The you had an article, I think it was in First Things, called Normophobia. And you kind of referenced it just a moment ago, talking about how, you know, there's this in the air we breathe today, there's this rejection of anything in the past. We always have to remake things in the name of progress in order to prove that we are progressing and we're better than our, you know, our forebears or whatever it may be. Okay, so let's unpack that more. Today, things are crazy. I think a lot of people acknowledge that, whether it's male-female relations or the state of a lot of disaffected men today, struggles women are experiencing, birth rates are declining. There's a lot of indicators that social fabric is wearing down and, you know, we're just having less family in general. Social bonds are wearing down, divorce rates, marriage is on decline, things like this. What does it mean then, I guess, to start with this? How do you say call yourself a feminist and yet say that you are, what is it about feminism that you are in support of? Let's start with that. The feminism of the last, say, 100 to 200 years.
Let's think about how we can unpack that, because there's probably several answers I need to give to that. The first thing I'd say is the feminism of the last 100 to 200 years, you need to tell that story in several stages. But the overall frame, really the overall argument of feminism against progress, is that the women's movement is not evidence of progress as such. This isn't just something, we didn't just wake up one day and decide to become better people collectively, you know, in some abstract way. That's not what happened. What actually happened was that men and women together, but particularly women, for reasons I'll get to, needed to respond to the way life was changed by the Industrial Revolution. And that's fundamentally what drove the women's movement. You know, in earlier civilizations, in pre-modern England, and really into the 19th century in the United States, the majority of men and women lived in basically agrarian settings. And, you know, there were some downsides to that, and it was a hard life for a lot of people. But the really key thing is that men and women both worked, and they did very distinct jobs. You know, men and women had different roles. But everybody worked within a productive household. And that completely changed when the Industrial Revolution happened. First, it took men out of the home. So men were the first people to be drained from the productive household into productive work elsewhere, in factories or in offices or wherever. But what also happened at that point was that women's productive work began to drain from the home where it had always previously happened. So whereas women might have worked previously on, you know, producing, you know, growing vegetables or animal husbandry or producing textiles or, you know, processing raw materials to make food, to prepare food for the, you know, 1,001 of the jobs that you need to do when you can't go to the shops and buy what you need. So much of this was women's work, and you do it all with your kids underfoot. But the Industrial Revolution comes along and suddenly, you know, life is very different. And instead of weaving fabric for the family, you can buy fabric. And instead of a whole lot of those, you know, instead of churning butter, you can buy it from the shop. And increasingly women are no longer doing the productive work that they'd done before, but they still need to look after the kids. So in fact, what happened in a very significant sense with the Industrial Revolution wasn't that women first began to move, you know, the progress story will tell you that women in the Middle Ages were sort of helpless, abused, kind of, you know, beaten up by cavemen, you know, chattel slaves effectively. This is not true. I mean, I don't know, maybe it is in some places, but in Anglophone heritage cultures, it's simply not true. It's much, the story, the picture is complex, but it's much, much, there's much more to it than that. And women in very different ways to the modern world had a lot of agency. And what happened actually in the early Industrial Revolution was that women lost agency. And then they needed to respond to that, because they'd inherited a legal system which saw the basic unit of civil, the basic unit of the state was not individuals but households, and that meant the head of a household. I mean, this is not how we organise things now. The basic economic unit is an individual now, but the basic economic unit in the legacy system that was in place in Britain and America when the Industrial Revolution happened saw the basic unit, the basic economic unit was a household, and that meant the head of the household, and that meant the wife was subsumed into the husband, and that meant that women basically had no legal or economic personhood. Separate from their husbands. So when women's work drains, women's agency and women's work drains out of the home, and but they still need to be at home to look after the kids, they're suddenly in this actually, relative to the Middle Ages, very disempowered situation where they can't leave. They can't divorce their husband. It's great, it's fine if your husband likes you and he's a good man and he supports you and does and steps up and does all. But there's very little push. You have very little redress if it's not fine and if he's not a good husband and if he beats you or if he divorces you or abandons you, you have no recourse. You have no legal personage. You can't divorce him. And if you do leave, he can keep the kids and you have no right. And there are some really horrendous stories. And so there's a lot of the early women's movement was about responding to this and saying, well, what do we do now? And so, you know, we need to be able to work if things go wrong. We need to be people in our own right in this changing world. And then there was also a whole other culture of maternalism, which really wanted to big up this domestic life that women now found themselves in, which was good if your marriage was good. You know, there were women, the 19th century maternalists were, they were huge on motherhood, on domesticity, on the importance of women's work in raising, uplifting the moral fabric of society and in uplifting and in shaping the moral outlook of their children, and the huge importance of that to the nation and to the common good. So there's also this whole story. And to be fair, 19th century women who were into this would not have described themselves as feminists. But to me, it reads straightforwardly as feminism, in the sense that it's about making the case for women's huge contribution to the common good. So in the sense of defending women's so this is the early women's movement. It's a very, very different place to this. I mean, people, in as much as pop feminism will tell you about the 19th century, they're just like, oh yeah, some racists, and then there was the vote, and then good, and now we're into the bit which matters, which is the sexual revolution. That's basically like the pop history of feminism you get now. And there's so much more to it than that. And there's this really interesting back and forth between the maternalists, who were very, who wanted to elevate and purify marriage. They wanted to save women from prostitution. They wanted to make the case for women's distinct but equal contribution to public life. They were hugely into social reform movements, so they would campaign for, you know, relief for the poor and, you know, do good works in their local area. And there's this huge, yeah, I mean, they basically were the social fabric. They were civil society. And this it's a hugely important and powerful aspect of women's history, which is very often kind of sidelined in this story about, you know, liberation and liberalism and the, you know, the kind of progressive narrative of what was going on with the women's movement. I mean, I could wang on about this for hours, but I won't. My point is that this is phase one, and phase one kind of came to an end with the contraceptive revolution, because at that point there was this back and forth between the feminism of care, which is, you know, the maternalists, if you like, and the feminists of freedom, who said we need to be able to get divorced. Both of these sides had a point, but really the women who wanted to enter the market on the same terms as men, which is to say the women who wanted to be liberated, as it were, their side pretty much comprehensively won at the point where the sexual revolution happened. Because at that point, a new technology arrived. So if you like, this is industrialization round two, which I think of as the industrialization of women's bodies through birth control and also through the legalization of abortion. Because at that point, you have a technology which seems to get rid of the main physiological difference between men and women and to bring about a much more complete equality than had really been possible before. And so there are whole new types of feminism which emerge from that. You know, the demand for equal access to work opportunities, a demand to break down sex segregation in social life. Hugely elaborate new movements for equality and abolishing sexism, and really all of the whole second wave women's movement is downstream of the sexual revolution. And this, you know, especially conservatives, that tends to be what they're referring to when they talk about feminism, is the second wave and on. You know, the stuff, the 19th century stuff, kind of, everyone's like, yeah, I don't really get that. I don't really understand any of that.
Well, I think the point you're making, the economic or the technological
changes, these dramatic changes, the Industrial Revolution, and later on, I mean, the term you use, the industrialization of women's bodies, I think that's so compelling about the rise of birth control and abortion on demand and these dramatic changes. It sounds like what you're saying is that, yes, ideologies, you know, feminist ideas, you could call them, were emerging, or there was, you know, talk of things, but they really were in many ways the consequence, you know, these changes in how women should interact in society, or these changes in ideas of how women should interact in society, were really the consequence of these very dramatic technological changes.
It's always hard to say whether it's the ideas that come first or the material changes. But I mean, what does seem to be clear is that these things come together. Like, you know, an idea, somebody can have a great idea, but unless it falls on fertile ground, it's just going to be an idea. And you only really see large scale social change when the material conditions make sense for it as well. So I don't really see it as one or the other, or I'd be loath to say it's caused more by ideology or more by material conditions. But I've opted to focus on, or to lean more into thinking about material conditions, because I just think it gets left out. Mm. And it's so, particularly once we get to the contraceptive revolution, I think we've hugely underpriced how transformative that was to our ideologies. And I think of it really as the first transhumanist moment. You know, I've argued that really we're 50 years into the transhumanist era, because the first transhumanist technology was the contraceptive pill. The reason I see it that way is because it in fact turns the medical it turns the whole history of medicine inside out. I mean, if you think about what medicine is meant to do, you know, up to the sexual revolution, up to the contraceptive revolution, the point of medicine, like, doctors all understood what a healthy human, what human normal looks like. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got a basic, I mean, you and I both have an idea of what a normal healthy person looks like, and what normal healthy human bodies ought to be able to do, and what is, you know. And up until the contraceptive revolution, the job of doctors was to try and get somebody who's sick, which is to say abnormal physically in some way, or back to some, you know, as close as possible to normal again. You know, your arm is broken, you want your arm not to be broken. You know, your head hurts, you want your head not to hurt. You know, something wrong with your kidneys, so you're not processing things properly. You want to fix the point of medicine is to get you back to normal. And what happens, and the contraceptive pill turns that completely inside out, because what it does, instead of fixing something which is wrong with normal, it fixes normal in the name of personal freedom. So instead of fixing something which is broken to try and restore us to normal, it takes something which is working fine, which is normal female fertility, and breaks it in the name of personal freedom. And that's a total inversion of what every doctor has done up until that point. And what it does is it opens the door for a whole new way of thinking about what medicine can and should do. So instead of fixing things which are wrong with us, now there's this whole new range of possibilities for ways we can effectively ways we can upgrade ourselves in line with what we want, rather than what is just normal. So I mean, if I can break my fertility in the name of having sex whenever I want with whoever I want, why shouldn't I interfere with my normal physiology in any number of other ways, just because I want to? And what that also does is it opens a whole new range of business opportunities for enterprising businesses or doctors or practitioners or pharmaceutical companies or whatever, to cater to this whole new market, which is and really what happens with the first transhumanist moment of the birth control pill is the opening up of human bodies as a marketplace. And that's what I see as the definitive transhumanist move is the point where we stopped treating the world as something to strip mine, to buy and sell, and started treating ourselves as a resource, as a marketplace. And so downstream of that moment, we start to see the commodification of women, for example, in the surrogacy industry, in the buying and selling of gametes, I mean, you know, it's no coincidence as well that the sex industry mushroomed in the downstream of the contraception. I mean, the causality there is pretty straightforward. If you can have consequence-free sex, why shouldn't you? And why shouldn't you make movies of it? So there's a whole load of dominoes that fall one after another, all of which make somebody a whole load more money. And it all sits on the foundation of this claim that we have a right to interrupt normal in the name of personal freedom, and that all begins with the first transhumanist moment, which is the contraceptive pill. So we're 50 years into this now, and a whole lot more has happened.
Abortion's the most extreme example of what you're saying, yes. The inversion of medicine and how we see medicine and how we see healthcare instead of to heal the patient, bring life to the patient, extend the life of the patient. Mm-hmm. Medicine Absolutely. Is now to kill someone First, who used to be a patient.
Right. This was a point that Erica really convinced me of. When she pointed out that this is also the moment where the maternalists just lost. You know, if previously in the women's movement there had been those women who wanted to make the case for mothers and for women as birthing mothers and as caregiving people, and to say that, you know, there are affordances of being a mother which we need to make space for, and there are ways in which women are different, and particularly when we're mothers, that we need to make space for, and this is a political question. That form of feminism was just lost when abortion was made legal, because it's very difficult. I mean, wherever you stand on abortion, it's very hard to argue that. I mean, you can't really make a much stronger statement in favor of freedom over care than to say, yeah, I have the right to choose, even at the expense of a potential human life that's reliant on the hospitality of my body. You know, if you're saying that, if you've signed up to that paradigm, you've chosen freedom over care. So, I mean, it's not really surprising that maternal feminism has not had a look in since. You know,
the inverse is if you choose care over freedom, then the societal construct today is, well, that's fully on you then. It's almost like you chose this privilege of sorts to be a caring mother as opposed to abortion or rejection of the child. And now society's not going to help. I mean, why should anyone bother to help you too much with that?
Exactly.
Because you could have chosen freedom.
Exactly. Exactly. And we're actually seeing the same argument happening now in the field of euthanasia. And the same, and it's very clear already from what's happening in Canada that the same logic applies. You know, the same logic of choice and the fact that it's all on you if you choose life is now playing out in so-called Canadian healthcare, which is to say, the choice, which is now available to have a doctor end your life for you. And it's, you know, there are horror stories that seem to come out on a monthly basis of people who are effectively being pressured into ending their lives. Much as, you know, countless women are pressured into ending the lives of an unborn child, because everybody around them doesn't want the burden of having to continue looking after them effectively. It's the same logic.
A big thank you to our sponsor, 7 Weeks. 7 Weeks Coffee is the brand that I love to drink. I drink it every morning. They've got amazing blends. This is gourmet, small batch, low acid, ethically sourced coffee. Every month it's roasted fresh, so you get fresh coffee directly to your door. What I love about 7 Weeks Coffee is that it's not only the highest end coffee and you're going to just enjoy your steaming cup of coffee, but that every time you buy from 7weekscoffee.com, you are supporting the pro-life movement. In fact, a full 10% of all revenue, not just profit, goes directly back to pregnancy resource centers to support moms and babies in need. In fact, 7 Weeks Coffee has supported over 800 pregnancy centers and donated over $325,000 to support moms and babies in need. In addition, they've just launched the Heartbeat Club. How cute is that? And the Heartbeat Club, you get 15% off all your orders, your subscription of coffee that comes monthly. In addition, if you use the code Lila at checkout, you'll get another 10% off. That's 25% off your first order. So join the Heartbeat Club today. Go to 7weekscoffee.com, use the code Lila at checkout, and enjoy your delicious pro-life coffee. We talk a lot about companies that share our values on the podcast. especially companies with excellent products and great customer service that are aligned with our pro-family, pro-life values. And that's why I love EveryLife.com. EveryLife.com has best-in-class diapers and wipes and baby products for your little one. They are as good or better than any of their competitors on the market. And what I love about EveryLife is they're donating money back to the pro-life movement. So you're going to get a diaper product that is best-in-class, that has great ethically sourced materials for your little one, that is leak-proof, that is comfortable. But in addition, you're supporting a company or partnering with a company that doesn't support abortion. The sad truth is Pampers, Huggies, some of these brands, did you know that they're actually paying directly and indirectly for abortions through their different employee programs? Not acceptable. That's why we should be behind companies like EveryLife. EveryLife has amazing products. The price point is good. You've got some great discount opportunities, and they are supporting our values. So go to EveryLife.com today. You can use the code Lila at checkout for 10% off your order. You can get a subscription, so you're getting your diapers and wipes on a regular basis and you save even more money. That's using the code Lila at checkout at EveryLife.com. I want to pick up something you said earlier, and then I want to talk about solutions in the in the current era that we find ourselves in. But you were talking about the economic contributions, effectively, of women in, say, the Middle Ages and, you know, a 19th century pre the Industrial Revolution, and how things just, you know, changed dramatically with the Industrial Revolution. Men leaving the home, the household economy was now very different, textiles and food and all the, you know, animal husbandry, all the things that typically would happen on the kind of family household project are now changing rapidly. But the core of what you, part of the core of what you were saying is that, you know, women had economic value, obviously for the sake of raising their kids with their spouses, but in order to develop the economy around their household so that they could raise their kids and feed themselves and shelter themselves, et cetera. And, you know, part of the change that happened was that now it wasn't needed anymore. You know, those economic mm-hmm. contributions in those ways were not needed anymore. And then you have the 1940s, housewife stereotype, right, who has the refrigerator and she has the washing machine and she has all of these tools that make her job theoretically even easier. And then you have Betty Friedan writing in The Feminine Mystique that this, you know, 1940s housewife is so miserable. Like, she's just bored out. She's basically bored out of her mind. She's stuck alone in suburbia with the white picket fence. You know, she's divided away from society or, you know, work that's contributing to the economy. And she's just with these very tiny children that need her so desperately. And she's lonely as can be. And she has this terrible, she's terribly disaffected. And so we've got to get her back into the workforce, right? So I'm curious how do you see that narrative? First of all, do you agree with that you know, framing, or is there something we're missing with the puzzle? Let's start with that.
I'm a little bit less marinated in American social history, so the pictures may be a little bit different between Britain and the US. I mean, the picture is definitely more complicated than that in the UK. I mean, I recommend to anybody who's interested in Betty Friedan and the early 20th century in the United States, I strongly recommend, there's a superb book by Christopher Lash called Women and the Common Life. And he has a really interesting comment there where he talks about the withdrawal of women into the suburbs in early 20th century America. And really the disintegration of these very rich maternalist networks, which had been heavily concentrated in urban environments prior to that. And throughout the 19th century, there's a huge maternalist movement in America in the 19th century also. And what Lash says about that disintegration and that withdrawal into the suburbs is that it really was revealed preference. It was what everybody wanted. Everybody wanted that freedom from interpersonal obligation. And then when they had it, they discovered some of them discovered that it sucked. And that in fact there was a trade-off in terms of alienation that comes with personal freedom. And I think that's part of the picture really through, you know, much, much more broadly than the story of the women's movement, that I think, you know, there are a huge number of areas where really we like the personal, we like the freedom to do what we do, to do our own thing. But then as it turns out, it's also quite lonely. And sometimes we have very mixed feelings about that. And this is something that we see again and again in all sorts of contexts. But perhaps it's particularly painful in the context of motherhood, because you're so needed by, you know, the little children's needs have not changed, right? You know, so even if you've decided you don't need other people, your children still need you, and the buck kind of stops with you. So I think, you know, you may, I mean, there was a whole argument on Twitter recently about, you know, there's this woman who doesn't want the nursing chair from her in-laws that's been in the family for generations, and her husband's really angry about it, but because it doesn't fit with her nursery theme. And he's really sore about it. And she's like, the chair that I bought was uncomfortable, but it's still mine, so there. And I was thinking, this is a really stupid thing to argue about. This is so
especially on Twitter.
Right. I mean, you know, you're crazy if you air that kind of stuff on Twitter. But the point is, you know, I thought she was nuts, but I could also completely see where she was coming from, because actually when we have kids, we do kind of want to do our own thing. And maybe actually if we were all living in multi-generational households, we'd absolutely hate it. I don't know. And there are times when I wonder if this, you know, there's an aspect to this atomization, which really is just revealed preference. And it just turns out that we're maybe not quite as ready for the trade-offs as we thought.
Well, you become ready for the trade-offs, right, in part through a sort of inculcation in the trade-off. You're raised with the trade-off. You're raised with the intergenerational household. You're raised with certain gender roles that your parents may be living out. And so it becomes more normal. You know, it becomes sort of second nature to you. If you're raised in an experimental household, let's say, or a more modern household, as we can call it today, it is harder for you to appreciate or be able to even have be habituated to appreciate the, you know, what we're talking about, these intergenerational households or these responsibility trade-offs, we could call them.
Just on Betty Friedan as well, her book was hugely influential, but it's also important to remember that, socioeconomically, she was elite. She was highly educated. She had a professional career before she became a mum. She never really gave it up. You know, she went on working. This idea that she was some kind of bored, alienated housewife is not completely true. You know, she went on working. I don't know.
She spun a strong narrative, Mary. I mean, I think she spun. She was a very talented writer, and she spun a very compelling picture that resonated to some degree with the experience, at least at some point, of many women, even if it wasn't the full picture, and that became its own force in politics,
exactly.
It was used politically.
I mean, my sense as well is that in her era, it was also becoming, again, for material reasons, it was genuinely becoming more possible for more women to do more work outside the home, because there just wasn't a whole lot to do for them inside the home. And that created a whole new set of tensions, because, you know, your kids still need you just as much. But then what else are you doing all day? And there were some women who were like, you know, I can fill up my time. And then there are others who are living in living in the suburbs a long distance from friends who they could meet up with, who were just really lonely and really bored. And who decided that actually probably the best solution is for me to find more work, and then set about trying to make that happen.
If you've written a fair amount on, you know, you comment on, you know, current events, obviously, frequently, and your Twitter, your X is quite interesting and fun. So I recommend the follow, move in circles on Twitter. Mary's a great follow. But, you know, here we are today. You made the comments about the, you know, economic or technological realities affecting, prevailing thoughts, our narratives about how we should behave and who we are as humans, et cetera. What do you think is the solution today to all the best?
I honestly don't think there is one. I mean, one conclusion I came, I'm sorry. I don't have a monocausal explanation for everything that's gone wrong, and nor do I have a single solution that's going to work for everybody. I just don't think it works.
What are some solutions?
Part of where liberal feminism has gone wrong is in proposing that, in fact, all of women's interests are identical. And that's just obviously not true. Mm-hmm. You know, I think, if you live on a little Greek island and everybody is still pretty traditional, then, you know, what I suggest might not actually make sense for you at all. But particularly in the context of, you know, extremely, you know, digitally advanced, post-industrial, highly networked Western kind of increasingly post-liberal, say, specific, you know, middle and upper class Britain and America. I have some thoughts. I have some suggestions. One of them is that we need to be getting married. I recommend, to me, marriage is a no-brainer. If you want, you know, it's straightforwardly a feminist project to be encouraging and supporting marriage from the kind of radically atomized point of view of, middle and upper class life in 20th century Britain and America. It's a complete no-brainer. Like, why would you not want to look for a good man who's got your back. But this is not to say any old marriage. I'm very keen on. I think we need to rethink what it's for, and I think we need to rethink what we're filtering for. You know, this sort of capstone marriage, which has become the norm now, where people wait until much later and they see it as kind of the icing on the cake of personal fulfillment. I think that's thinking about it wrong. And actually, what we need to be seeing getting married as an enabling condition for life in common, and particularly for kids. And we should possibly be filtering less for the big romance and the one in the rom-com sense, and more for loyalty, for shared values, and for the long haul, really. And we should be thinking about it in those terms. And the reason I say this is actually because I don't believe in never-ending progress. And I think, you know, life might go on getting richer and more safer and more comfortable for a tiny minority in extremely wealthy parts of the world. But for a lot of people, it's going in the opposite direction. And that means for a lot of women, it's going in the opposite direction. And I think about my own daughter, who's 7. And I think about the world she's going to grow up in. And I think, would I rather tell her that she can girl boss it all on her own and have her go into adult life with those beliefs? Or would I rather encourage her to find a good guy who's going to have her back? You know, given the poly crisis, given possible climate change, given rising crime rates, given all of the other things which seem to be going pear-shaped, you know, what should I be encouraging her to do? You know, it's pretty obvious. Maybe she'll be lucky, but maybe she won't.
And the prerequisites in your view, Mary, for that, because there's a big debate about that, when to get married, how to marry. I know you're recommending don't just go for this romantic, ideal rom-com, the one perfect experience of the thing, you know, look for the shared values, look for the person that has your back. But, you know, I think there is a recommendation for many to, you know, get your college degree, put a few years into the workforce, you know, get yourself in an economically good place. And this is for the message for both men and women. And then, you know, you hit your 30s, you hit a certain period of time, and then you get married once you've got establishment, a certain level of economic establishment taken place.
I think Princeton mom was right. She got so much blowback for saying that you're never going to be more surrounded by eligible men than when you're at college. But I don't know. I think she was right. You know, for that kind of elite women, you're never going to be as surrounded by eligible men as you will be at college.
The missus degree.
it's not terrible advice. I don't know. You know, your mileage may vary, but it's not the worst advice in the world. Thinking of marriage as an enabling condition, and thinking of it as, you know, it's not something that you opt in. That you opt in and out of. It's not something you do with your options open. Once you're doing it, you're doing it for the long haul. But if you're going to do that, then we need, you know, if we want good men, if we want to marry good men, then there needs to be some good men. I mean, this is a little bit more difficult to argue succinctly, but my view is that we just need to leave men alone to hang out with each other a little bit more. And we probably might possibly get more support in protecting single-sex women's spaces, for example, from men who say they're women, if we let men have some of their own single-sex spaces, maybe a little bit more. And this is a talking point that doesn't usually leave the manosphere, and it can sometimes take on a kind of nasty tone, which I don't share. But I think there's something to it, because, I mean, there's a big argument going on in Britain at the moment about the Garrick Club, which is a very elite private members club in London, where there are, which is one of the very few exclusively all male one. It doesn't admit women except as guests. And there's a huge argument going on about whether or not it's socially acceptable for this place to still exist. I don't care. Leave them alone. But I think there are some high-powered, ambitious women who say these spaces shouldn't exist because it allows men to gatekeep access to power and resources and deal-making and networking in a way which is structurally sexist and fundamentally unfair. Maybe. But if you apply that logic all the way down the social scale, it ends up affecting, it ends up also dissolving single-sex spaces for men who are not gatekeeping resources, and they're not gatekeeping networks, and they're not gatekeeping power. Or anything, really. They just want to have a few beers with their friends, and now they sort of can't because it's sexist. And I think that's a contributing factor in rising male loneliness. I also think it's a contributing factor in the disintegration of male mentorship networks, which are fundamentally what are required to form the next generation of good men. And if we won't leave space for men to form one another down the generations, then there will be no good men. And then we'll end up with no male role models apart from these usually really quite toxic, high profiles kind of masculinist role models. I won't name any names, but I'm sure you know the kind I'm talking about. They crop up on the internet and they're usually pretty contemptuous of the opposite sex. And they sort of talk about weightlifting and making money, and it's just very crass. And actually what it would be so much better if we just left the guys alone so they could, I don't know what they talk about when we're not around, but I think we should leave them alone to do it. And this is, yeah. And that it would be better for everybody. There would be more good men to marry if we did. And point number three is the feminist case against birth control, for all the reasons I've already gone into earlier on the programme. Again, I think this is a very anti, to be clear, this is an anti-universalist argument. You know, I'm not even necessarily making this case for everybody. You know, I wouldn't recommend to somebody who has low social status or, you know, is in a violent relationship or has no personal capacity for self-control necessarily to reject the pill if that was going to keep her safe. You know, I wouldn't necessarily recommend it to somebody with no impulse control. But for women who otherwise have their thing together, you know, who are capable of self-control and who are capable of maintaining personal boundaries, you should not be on birth control. You should not be on the pill. It messes with your mind. It makes you fat and mad and sexless. And it reorders you as a kind of commodity for consumption in a way which is profoundly counter to your interests. I think there's a powerful, particularly, yeah. I mean, this is really addressed more towards bourgeois women in the developed world than anywhere else. But for that demographic, there's a strong feminist case against contraception, and so that's point three on my slightly eccentric set of feminist program for renewal out the other side of liberal feminism and into the reactionary kind.
Oh, I appreciate it. I asked this, and I know we've got to wrap here in a moment. I asked this of Erica when she was on this show. We had Carrie Gress, who's a bit of disagrees with Erica and sort of the historical view that you, I think, and Erica share to a large degree about how we got where we are. But I asked this question: should we continue to use this term feminist? Clearly, you've chosen to. It's been hijacked quite terribly, I would argue, in the last several decades. What's your take on that?
I mean, again, your mileage may vary. I like it. I mean, reactionary feminists started as a joke, seriously. It really did. I had a long argument with somebody about whether I had post-liberal feminist on my Twitter bio, and then I had a long argument with somebody about whether I should use post-liberal. Because he said I shouldn't because reasons. It went on for ages. I'm not going to bore you with the whole argument. But the long story short, in the end, I decided he won. I agreed with him, and I was going to change it to reactionary because that was just a better term. So I changed it to reactionary feminist. And then Matt Schmitz from First Things got in touch like a week later, saying what is a reactionary feminist? Will you please explain at length in First Things? And I'm like, okay. Now I have to figure out what I mean by that. And I'm like, this is literally just a joke, which I coined to put on my Twitter profile. So, and then it turned into a 1500 word article, which is kind of the thesis of the book. So obviously I meant something by it. But now it's a thing. I mean, I've come across people who describe themselves as reactionary feminists in the wild. You know, I'm comfortable with it. You know, it's a thing. It has a Wikipedia page. I don't, but reactionary feminism does.
Well done, Mary.
I'm sticking with it. It seems, but what I've loved about it is that it really works as a signal scrambler. People aren't completely sure where to put you, or at least they weren't for a long time. Now they're like, oh, it's the reactionary feminist, and like it's a thing now. But for a long time, it just scrambled everybody, so they didn't know where to place me, and I just had fun with that. So yeah.
Well,
I mean,
hopefully
you
keep the attention along for the ride, and you can share your thoughts with them along the way.
But you know, I mean, I think it's become a very empty signifier. in the West, feminism. You know, the liberals want it just to be the doctrine of whatever and wherever and whoever for anyone. It's just, you know, the doctrine of total gratification of individual desire is just what feminism means for the liberals. But then, so it's sort of content free at that end. And I think, you know, why shouldn't we take it back? You know, it does mean something. Women still exist. You know, we're still distinct from men in some politically important ways. Why shouldn't we have it back? You know, why shouldn't we take our ball and go home? It could just as easily be ours as theirs. So I'm going to have it back.
I'm with you. Equal but different. And to not reject the differences and instead to celebrate them and encourage them, I think, is the key to help women be fully, not free, but fully, I think, whole. And then the same with men. I mean, and yes, fully free towards the end of wholeness. You know, freedom, that word has been so perverted today to mean, you know, endless choices at for any reason, as opposed to what is my responsibilities, what is my purpose, and aiming your choices, your freedom towards those things. Mary, this has been fascinating. Your delight. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you
the podcast.
For having
Where can
me.
People find your work?
So you can find me at Unheard, UNHERD. That's where most of my regular column is. Reactionary Feminist on Substack. That's my personal newsletter. And on Twitter, I'm at Move in Circles.
Excellent. Thanks so much, Mary.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks so much for listening to this episode of the Lila Rose podcast. It was a delight to get to chat with Mary. I hope you follow her work. Obviously, some of her last comments, she was saying, well, for some women, I guess I could say that birth control is fine. I would say for any woman, birth control is not going to be helpful to you. If you're in an abusive relationship, birth control is not going to help you because you should get out of that relationship. And if you don't have good self-control, birth control is not going to help you because if you live without self-control, eventually that birth control is going to fail you and you will be faced with probably an unexpected pregnancy. So bottom line is, it's not good for anybody. So maybe that's one tiny point of departure between Mary and I, but overall, I thought she had such great things to share. As always, don't forget to subscribe to the show. You can do that on podcast apps or on YouTube, and send me an email. I love to hear what you guys think about the show, about what we're talking about, any guest ideas, topic ideas. You can email me at Lila@gtbmedia.com. That's Lila@gtbmedia.com. The GTB, by the way, is Goodness, Truth, Beauty. So email me at Lila@gtbmedia.com. And also, don't forget to join our locals and our Patreon communities. We have great things in store coming down the pipeline. As you guys know, I'm on maternity leave right now. I'm filming this before, but I'll be back soon, and we're going to be doing some very exciting things. So that's Patreon and locals. You can get those links in the bio. Thanks so much, and we'll see you next time.